actually worked. It's running.
This is Roosevelt Gist with AutoNetwork, and we're here in Nashville, Tennessee with General Motors for the launch of the new 2008 GM collection. And my guest on this show is Brent Dewar, Vice President of everything at GM, seems like.
Some days.
Brent, thanks for taking the time.
It's great to be with you again. I think the last time we were overlooking a beautiful vineyard in California. So now we're on, be back on your show.
Now we're on a golf course.
It's not bad. We should. I'm not a good golfer. How about you?
No, I don't play at all.
Oh, my God. I play, but I shouldn't. So it's good to be with you.
In your presentation this morning, you indicated that obviously you all are moving in the right direction. You had a market share increase recently. And being a huge global company like General Motors, are there any design features or engineering techniques that you may have picked up in some of the other countries that you applied to new product that worked here in the U.S.?
Yeah, we've been in a series of what we refer to as a transformation, our company. We've always been a global car company, produced all over the world, proud to be an American global car company. And our transformation changed about 3 to 4 years ago. And so what we look now is we look on what are these changing trends, elements around the world, and try to bring them with the right fit to each of the markets. So I'm responsible for just the North American sales. I have had a chance to work around the world with General Motors. And the market's changing. The market has been changing. You're seeing vehicles go more to luxury. You're also seeing vehicles go much smaller. You're seeing vehicles going to different types of fuel energy sources to power them. So the traditional gasoline engine is changing dramatically. We're seeing some countries like Brazil that have made the shift and gone to renewable fuel sources like ethanol. We're going to see that probably develop here in America. So ethanol coming to the U.S. as an alternative to gasoline. We're seeing in this country electrification coming back. You know, as you know, we started with the EV1. Very proud of our early work on the electric vehicle. Technology is improving along the way. And that early EV1 work now leads to what most consumers know today as hybrids. The real exciting thing is the next generation electrification. We shared with you at the International Auto Show in Detroit this new concept we refer to as the Chevrolet Volt. And that vehicle runs purely on electricity. You can travel 40 to 50 miles and never use any petroleum, no gasoline. Really simply just plug it in, recharge it. For consumers that want to travel more than 40, 50, instead of having a full engine like a hybrid does, it just has a small engine, and that engine doesn't run the vehicle. It just regenerates the electric battery that's on the vehicle. So we think this is a real big breakthrough. We're working with suppliers to develop lithium-ion batteries, but just really exciting. The other big thing that we're working on and we've been doing for a number of years is the role that we believe hydrogen will play. And hydrogen's an energy source. It's plentiful. It's everywhere. It can come from the super clean sources like solar and wind and water. It can come from other cheaper sources, like coal and things like that. So depending on where you get your source of energy, what's exciting about hydrogen, whether it's compressed or liquid, it creates energy and electricity on the vehicle. And what comes out the tailpipe is water. As a car guy like me, I mean, how cool is that?
Is it drinkable? Are we going to find GM bottled water now out there?
that's an interesting marketing thought. Leave that one with me. I'm gonna take that one with me. But what's really cool about hydrogen fuel cells is that, our goal is to take the vehicle out of the energy of debate. That's General Motors' role. So not one of these technologies is the answer. We believe there's five different pathways because the needs in South America are slightly different than needs in America. The needs in Asia Pacific are slightly different than Europe. We need to develop solutions that are right for the consumers that also meet the needs of those countries and regions. I would say, Roosevelt, that is probably the most exciting transformation. We've always been a global car company, but seeing how amazing ideas. Well, look at this. We're doing this as an internet. My goodness. I mean, you've got all these fans and customers out there want to get information. And the digital environment is allowing cultures and markets to come closer together. It's very different. They're not becoming homogeneous. The differences are very clearly delineated. But what we're finding in this great world of ours, we're more alike than different. And so what we need to do is capitalize on our similarities and accentuate our differences. And that's kind of the new forefront of marketing.
Let me ask you this. As you know, the American consumer is very tough to satisfy. Now, in the presentation last night, you surprised me and had Dave Lyons do an interior presentation, which I don't think you all have ever done that I can remember. What is it? What made you decide to focus on the little things like interior from a quality standpoint? And would you give a similar presentation, say, in Brazil?
Great question. That's a good example of the kind of change that's happening both in not just in our company, but in the industry specifically. You know, consumers are spending more time in their vehicle.
But that's always been the case.
but they're using it more of a destination.
Right.
So I wouldn't say American consumers are more demanding. They're demanding everywhere. And so although you might say that, you know, they were spending time in their vehicles before, the creature comforts are getting better, the feel and tactile. So I would say our company had always been more about what we would refer to as bending sheet metal, the exterior part of design. And we have Bob Lutz. You've met Bob.
Yes.
He's a character. And Bob is passionate about all vehicles, but he's really passionate about interiors. And we started to listen to our customers a little bit closer. And sometimes you let the research do the talking. Very much support research, but you have to use common sense. And you know, we sell, you know, 9 million vehicles out there a year, and you just need to talk to your customers, and they kind of tell you what you need to listen to. A little more of this, a little bit less of that. And then you let your designers go forward. You know, our great heritage of our company has been when design went first. And it was a paradigm to show, and that was, I'm glad you noticed that. You know, I never thought in my career the lead off would be the interior designer. But the work is so interesting. And if you see some of the work we're doing on the Cadillacs and the Saturns and the Chevys, you know, the sewing, the stitches, when you get into the CTS, you fire it up and you push the button. It's a beautiful design of the interior, all flush mounted. Up pops the screen, and in that screen is all your navigation and infotainment and entertainment. Very cool.
Now, what took you all so long to go to a long-term warranty? Did the competition kind of push you in that direction, or you just felt that the product was ready and you could handle it?
You know, it's not so much. No, definitely the competition didn't push us that way. I mean, it's something we had been studying for a long time, and it's really a manifestation of our quality. We do it because we can, and we've been working so hard. Quality, people say quality is a given these days. It's never a given. It's like God's work. It's never done. You just got to keep working harder and harder to make the vehicles, because the consumers are asking for this trouble-free environment. But, you know, vehicles are complex things, and we do our very best that, you know, nothing goes wrong. But we wanted to give the consumers confidence that we'll back you up. And for 100,000 miles or 5 years, you've got the protection from General Motors. And what's interesting about it is it's fully transferable. So it helps the ownership value to the consumers. So when they sell the vehicle, if they want to sell it within that 5-year, 100,000-mile time frame, it goes to the next consumer. So we think it's a big statement. We think it's a simple statement. And our reasons for purchase consumers are very gratifying that. We have lots of consumers that know us well. We have some that don't know us, if you can believe that. They've never had a chance to experience a Chevy or a Cadillac or a Saturn. And in marketing terms, it just gives you that confidence to try a brand. Our goal in marketers is to try to keep all the customers that know us and try to get a few from our competition. Their goal is to keep all theirs and get a few from us. And that constant competitiveness makes us all better.
What did you learn from the turnaround of Cadillac that you can apply to the other brands?
I think Cadillac started the transformation, and we led with our premium brand. What Cadillac did very successfully is, at that time period, there was a lot of talk about retro and heritage, and there was a lot of mixing of terms, like go back and make what you used to do in the 50s and 60s. Our customers and research told us that's not the right way to go. So what we tried to do is bring forward the heritage, the elements that truly define what a Cadillac should be. So we would refer to it as a nod to the past and go back to what makes a Cadillac great, but totally forward-looking. And so what we learned with Cadillac, we took a risk on the design. We saw a design change happening, and that was the early formation of this global design centers. We call this fusion of design concepts, like you know, what's happening in Europe and what's happening in South America and Asia, here in America, West Coast, East Coast. And so we saw a change in design direction, and we created what we call this chisel design look of Cadillac. That was definitely very forward-looking. And we learned that the consumers responded very positive to that. But we gave a nod back to the heritage of what truly meant a Cadillac. We quite frankly, we got away from it for a while. And the consumers told us not to go back where we used to be, but, you know, make great Cadillacs again. What you're seeing here at this launch is the next generation CTS. The CTS first generation was this new design look. What you're seeing this is a nod back to the first first generation CTS, but it's a much more contemporary version. And yes, we have Dave Lyons' interior. It's amazing. We weren't as focused on. We had a nice interior in the first CTS, but it was more about the design and the driving dynamics. This, we're taking the design and driving dynamics and really going way further on the interior.
Now, I think you've totally confused the Pontiac buyer in terms of what Pontiac is. What is it now that GM says the Pontiac brand represents?
Yeah, Pontiac is Pontiac. I would say Pontiac and Buick are in their earliest stages of their transformation, and so we're kind of a little bit between. You know, Pontiac still has a very strong value equation. It still is the entry level brand for our channel. And what we mean by a channel is three differentiated brands going through one dealership point: Pontiac, Buick, GMC. And we think those three differentiated brands, if we can execute them well, then it'll be a great business for not only the dealer, but also for us and the consumers. And you have kind of one-stop shopping with those three brands. So Pontiac is kind of moving away from where it was in terms of proximity to Chevrolet. It's moving back to its performance, not going back to muscle cars, but kind of a nod to thoughtful performance when Pontiac was great. So you're going to see vehicles come to market like the Solstice. You're going to see vehicles come to market like the next generation G8, rear-wheel drive, all-wheel drive, thoughtful performance, definitely not muscle cars. The muscle cars would be retro because today it's not about muscle. It's about, as I talked about, the energy and environment and trying to do the right balance. Consumers love performance. They love driving dynamics, and you can do that in a thoughtful way. So we're working on that, trying to define that. We've had tremendous success with Pontiac in the movement of that shift, quite frankly, to markets that had not experienced it before, the West Coast of the United States, California, Oregon, Seattle, starting to see it. Pontiac does very well with female buyers, and we're excited about that. It also does well with our youthful buyers. And so you'll see a lot of kids on college looking up and surfing. And we measure all this stuff. So if you're wondering about digital, we know you're out there. So we know when you're shopping a Pontiac versus another competitor. And that's interesting for us. And so it's touching those brand cues, and it's work in progress. So those of you that love Pontiac, stay tuned. We're going to come with a lot more great Pontiacs.
Now, Saturn was the rave because of the sales process, and it probably people think of Saturn as how to buy a car, one price. But there's more to Saturn than that. How are you going to get the consumer beyond this is the way you're supposed to buy the car to this is the car that I really want to buy because of its design and quality?
If you go back when Saturn started 15 years ago, we were probably not in the best time and place in terms of the buying and selling experience for the entire industry. And you know, the consumers are really looking for a different way, and Saturn created a process of how to, we actually refer to it, even our competitors refer to it as what would Saturn do. And so we really, we latched onto something. We've taken a lot of those lessons from Saturn and moved them to our premium divisions and, you know, luxury divisions and even in Chevrolet. But Saturn has this unique experience, and it's more than just one price selling or no haggle pricing. It's really about how they approach the customer for a total 360 view of the ownership. You know, like anything, we probably weren't refreshing the product as fast as we could. Saturn kind of got trapped down in just small cars when the market started to segment a little bit away from it. So we've made a huge investment capitalizing on this ownership experience, but now coming with a complete renaissance of new products. If you see the new View all-wheel drive vehicle, small sport utility, I don't care. It'll stack up against any Honda, Toyota, any domestic. It is a remarkable vehicle, and it's a Saturn. And so the designers have really gone back and looked at it. What we've also done, which is interesting, is now this new global process. We have some regional brands that many Americans aren't familiar with, but you can go out and surf. Right. You can go surf and look them up. You know, brands like Opel in Europe or Holden's in Australia. You know, these are exciting brands, Vauxhall in Great Britain. And so we're leveraging some of those European design cues. We're not taking them and making them Saturns, but they're working together. So they're kind of partnering on a global basis to be bigger than their individual parts. And so Saturn's going to have this great ability to develop future generation products with our European design studios that make some of these other great regional brands. And so the future of Saturn's really bright. And you see the new View, Saturn Aura is a great little car and a midsize segment. The Outlook is a full sport utility. So we're changing what Saturn means and allowing those consumers that have known Saturn these past 15 years to kind of move with us. And they're bringing in new products like the Saturn Astra later in the year, which is worked with our European design studios.
Now, you have probably one of the biggest icons in the industry right now in Bob Lutz. And I know this is a team sport. Bob has all the passion there is you can ever find in a car guy. When he walks away, who's going to step in with that kind of passion, or has that finally permeated throughout the organization?
Yeah, we have always had our own car guys in the company as well. And like all great car companies, you just got to keep nurturing them and growing them. What Bob was great at doing, and Bob started at General Motors, left us, went to a few other places and came back. And if you haven't met him, he's a treat. he's quite a guy. He's tough. And he's passionate. We've always had that in our company. And so what he's done successfully is allowed the car people, and I'm one of them, to kind of come to the front and to have a bigger seat at the table. And so we're glad to have him. We'd love for him to stay as long as he wants to stay. And if you know Bob, they're going to have to drag him and take him dragging and kicking, because he likes making cars and trucks. And but the culture's alive and well. You had a chance last night to meet our interior designer, Dave Lyons. And the design team with Ed Welburn's leadership, you know, they're really gaining confidence and knowing where the market's going around the world, and knowing you have somebody like Bob Lutz and Rick Wagner and Fritz Henderson supporting you gives them a lot of confidence, because in this business you have to take a little bit of risk. You know, you have to take a risk, you know, whether it's design risks or, you know what, it doesn't make a lot of sense right now economically to develop hydrogen fuel cells. We're going to do it because it's the right thing to do, because if we're going to take ourselves out of the energy debate, you got to get started. You can't wait for somebody else to do it. We're going to do this Chevy Volt because it's the right thing to do. And that's what's exciting. And that's the kind of confidence Bob brings. And there's one thing he does not lack, and that's confidence.
Now, these events are primarily for the media. And I'm sure that we don't always get the message across that you really want consumers to know about GM and not necessarily about each specific brand. But tell me a little bit about what you want consumers to really know about the new General Motors.
Well, I think it's just that. I mean, we're a very successful car company for many years. We are going through a transformation. And some of the challenges, if you're just here as in America, some of our challenges here are really have nothing to do about cars and trucks. It's about some of the economics of the auto industry in America. And in the last couple of years, we've been selling more vehicles abroad outside the U.S. than we do in this country. That's kind of good and bad. I mean, the good news is our brands are well accepted around the world as global brands go. I would say, if you don't know us, you need to get to know us. We build great fuel-efficient, great quality vehicles, amazing designs. We're a young company. The leadership's young. If you meet the leadership of the company, and Bob included. And when I mean young, it's not age or chronological. There's not a younger thinker on the planet than somebody like Bob Lutz. And that's that youthful, you know, thinking of how we do it. And at the end of the day, we get to wake up in the morning to make cars and trucks. I mean, I tell the story, I think you might have heard it. I grew up in a non-car company and in the West Coast, and my dad was a high school principal, and I had no car influences, none. And I was the fourth of five kids, and we used to sit back. And we had station wagons. I couldn't tell you if they were Chevys or Fords or what they were. There's brown ones and blue ones. And my role was to sit in the third seat, looking backwards at life. And I had a younger sister, 5 years younger. And if you guys understand what that means, I mean, she drove me crazy. You know, what's that? What's that? What's that? You know, like forever on these family trips. And one day when I was between 9 and 10 years of age, I was watching Wide World of Sports, and I saw a car racing, and it was a split-window Corvette. And that moment, as a 9-year-old, I fell in love with cars. And I fell in love with a Corvette, and I learned everything I could about Corvettes. Fast forward, make it all the way through high school, college. I'm in an interview, and I'm doing the GM interview for practice. And I realized in the interview, oh, my God, these are the Corvette guys. So I straightened up my tie, like it's the only tie I had. So I had to look like a suit that day. So I zip up the tie and put on my best-selling piece. And so here's this young kid, 9 years of age, falls in love with the only car he ever noticed in his life, a Corvette. And then you fast forward to becoming the general manager of Chevrolet and bringing the sixth-generation Corvette to market. And it's yours. You're part of the design team and development team that makes the current generation Corvette. I mean, what a blast. I mean, there's no greater thrill or excitement. And that's what our industry does for you. I mean, it's cars and trucks. And then when we get this whole, you know, energy debate and finding solutions that are right for energy and environment and economics, pretty cool job.
Great. Brent, thanks for taking the time.
Thank you. Great to be with you again.
This is Roosevelt Gibbs with Auto Network, and we're here in Nashville, Tennessee, with General Motors for the new 2008 GM collection. And as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. See you next time.